Hafidae, and welcome to this series about ancient sites and traditions of Micronesia. These episodes introduce the latest research and discussions about ancient life, history, and cultural traditions all across our diverse region of Micronesia. I hope that you like this series, and I look forward to learning more together. Especially during the last few years, people have grown concerned about changing sea level, and I would advocate for a stronger role of the archaeological and geological evidence toward understanding how sea level can change, how we can document it through the objective physical evidence, and how we can learn more about the consequences in various aspects of natural and cultural history over extended time periods. Studies about sea level comprise one important part about how we as people relate with our environments. These interactions occurred over multiple successive generations and sometimes over a few hundreds of years. These situations can be understood not as singular or abrupt events, but rather as extended long-term processes of dynamic relationships. While the sea level and coastal environment change through periods of several years, decades, or centuries, gradually the later generations of people lived in somewhat different locations or housing formats, obtained different foods from the new habitat ecology, and expressed themselves in new fashions that differed in some ways from the lives of their more distant ancestors, in total representing the change of lifestyle that people needed to make in order to adapt with their changing world. Nonetheless, these ancient people sustained many other aspects of their lives that remained consistent with their older traditions, especially in terms of the cultural knowledge, indigenous history, and inherited language. In a modern parallel today, we can imagine the kinds of change in lifestyle that we will need to make with our situation of rising sea level and changing environment. In this case, driven by a change in world climate, with overall warmer temperatures and greater instability of weather patterns. At a global scale, at least some people have been addressing these issues for the last several decades, but only recently the latest few younger generations have started to make the deep lifestyle changes that will be necessary at a large scale, such as with reducing our carbon footprints, investing in natural renewable energy, and increasing the roles of household-based and community-based farming, forestry management, and food production with long-term sustainability. If we can learn more about how people in the past adapted with these situations, then we can learn how to build on the parts that were successful and to avoid the parts that were unsuccessful. Of particular interest, we can learn how to sustain the important elements of culture, history, and language while adapting with our modern and future circumstances. At a large scale view of the world over the last several thousands of years, the major periods of changing sea level have been linked with the global trends of either warmer or cooler temperatures. For instance, during ancient ice age periods of colder global temperatures, more of the world's ocean water was trapped in glaciers and ice sheets, and therefore the sea level was significantly lower. During warmer periods of time, some of the ice melted and went back into the world's oceans, and then the sea level began to rise higher. Over time, many fluctuations have occurred in global climate and temperatures, and accordingly the periods of changing sea level have occurred at variable scales. Some of these periods involved perhaps a few centimeters of different sea level over a few hundreds of years. Others involved several meters or tens of meters of different sea level over some thousands of years. In the islands of Pacific Oceania, the history of sea level has been documented in higher resolution than in other parts of the world, in time periods of a few hundreds of years each, and within magnitudes of 1 meter or smaller. Moreover, the sea level history has been coordinated with the chronology of cultural layers about when people first started to live in each island group, and how the later generations of people adapted with the next several centuries of changing sea level and coastal ecology. This approach in archaeology generally has been understood as a hybrid field of geoarchaeology or paleolandscape archaeology, combining the lines of evidence about natural history and cultural history into a holistic chronology of what happened over the last thousands of years. These investigations have illustrated how the physical landscape has changed through different periods of sea level and coastal ecology while revealing the realistic parameters of the landscapes and habitats where people could have lived during those different time periods. Currently, these findings have allowed us today to know where to look and how deep to excavate in order to find the ancient layers of coastlines and habitats of each measured time period, usually within increments of a few hundreds of years each. Only some, but not all, of these ancient surfaces have retained the material evidence of old house posts and cooking hearths, broken pottery and other artifacts, and concentrations of food middens. Within this framework, each archaeological layer can be dated and situated in terms of what the surrounding coastal environment looked like during that particular time interval. This approach has been especially productive in the islands of Pacific Oceania because of how the coral reefs have grown through time. Portions of the ancient coral reefs still can be observed, and they can be compared against the modern-day coral reefs in terms of the elevations of tidal notches and other elements. Moreover, they can be dated directly by radiocarbon and other chronometric techniques. In some cases, excavations have exposed the ancient floors of lagoons, and the beds of bioclasts have been measured in their elevation relative to present sea level and dated back to their original time periods. These kinds of direct observations and objective measurements have been repeated throughout different island groups and across most of Pacific Oceania, in total revealing the overall sea level history at a large cross-regional scale. Furthermore, these findings have been consistent with the expectations of global sea level history. Within the overall sea level history, some isolated instances have shown slight differences due to the localized effects of tectonic uplift or subsidence of a landform mass. These location-specific factors become obvious when knowing about the larger cross-regional history of how the sea level itself has changed through time. The complete body of evidence allows for distinguishing between the change in the volume of water in the world's oceans at a global scale versus any isolated change in a particular location-specific landform moving upward or downward. The combined archaeological and geological records have shown us what happened through time with changing sea level and coastal ecology, including how people adapted with each different time period. Instead of us today reaching from our modern world into the distant past, we can allow for the evidence to present itself in its own natural chronological order. Otherwise, modern perceptions often have been misled by the superficial effects of the most recent rising sea level or by the localized factors of landmass uplift or subsidence, masking the long-term records of the past and the broader cross-regional records. Moreover, modern perceptions of the past tend to be biased, whether intentionally or not, based on the portions of history that are most relevant for us today, or based on the remnants of archaeological sites that are accessible to us on the present-day ground surface and linked with the known written and unwritten histories of the more recent centuries. The first modern humans, or Homo sapiens, ever to live in the Asia-Pacific region came here at least 50,000 years ago during an ancient ice age when sea level was much lower than today. Due to the lower sea level, broad land ridges and lowland shelves extended around the larger land masses of the Asian continent, the islands of Southeast Asia, and the ancient supercontinent combining Australia and New Guinea. During this ancient time, small communities of hunter-gatherers moved across the land masses and across the short distances of water gaps, generally voyaging within about 100 kilometers and never crossing outside the site of land or beyond 350 kilometers. The next major change in sea level occurred at the end of the last ice age of the Pleistocene, about 10,000 years ago. With the warmer global temperatures during this next time of the Holocene, sea level began to rise and to flood over the land bridges and coastal lowlands. Due to the larger water gaps across the region, the communities of hunter-gatherers became more separated or isolated from each other, and the next generations of people developed more diverse differences from each other, continuing over the next several thousands of years. Throughout this time, however, nobody successfully crossed the boundary of the ocean into remote Oceania, referring to the voyaging distance outside the site of land and necessarily beyond 350 kilometers. The first people to break this boundary to live in remote Oceania came to the Mariana Islands around 3,500 years ago. During this ancient time, sea level was about 1.8 meters higher than the present day, and the coastal ecology was significantly different, even including entirely separate coral reefs and ecosystems. This temporary high stand of sea level started about 5,000 years ago, and it continued until about 3,100 years ago as measured in the Mariana Islands. Several places throughout these islands have shown the same ancient coastline and coastal habitat period, yet only some locations have retained the direct physical evidence of people living in these specific settings. So far, at least 9 such ancient cultural sites have been confirmed in 3 separate islands of Guam, Tinian, and Saipan. The ancient archaeological layers have revealed the remains of houses where people lived at the water's edge, the pottery and other artifacts that they made and used, and the traces of shellfish and other meals that they consumed during their lives. When the sea level began to draw downward, starting about 3,100 years ago, then the next generations of people adapted to live in slightly different positions of a changing coastline, to produce new styles of pottery and shell ornaments, and to rely on different sources of shellfish and other foods in their new habitat ecology. Similar periods of changing circumstances occurred over the next thousands of years, in total depicting a series of time periods of a few hundreds of years each. During each measurable time period, the physical records have shown the change in sea level, coastal habitat and ecology, placement of housing, choices of shellfish and other foods, and forms and styles of pottery, shell ornaments, rock art, and other cultural expressions. The same research approach has been productive in other parts of Pacific Oceania, such as with the Lapita sites in the Bismarck Archipelago, in New Caledonia, and in Fiji. In all of these cases, the records have shown how people first lived at the ancient seashores of a slightly higher sea level around 3,000 years ago or earlier, yet this lifestyle was short-lived due to the drawdown in sea level very soon thereafter. Moreover, in all of these cases, the people during the earliest habitation period created finely decorated pottery and exquisite shell ornaments. And then the later generations of people stopped making these artifacts and instead produced more plain or utilitarian practical objects when they adapted to a new world with a different sea level and coastal habitat ecology. Based on these observations, we can understand that ancient people adapted to a change in sea level and environment over an extended period of time, measured in a few hundreds of years and necessarily involving at least a few generations of people. The later generations lived in slightly different locations, gathered or grew different kinds of foods, and expressed themselves through new variations of art forms. Although these aspects of life changed, the indigenous people of course sustained many of the core elements of their ancestral cultural knowledge and practice, their remembered history, and their languages. In other words, people changed some aspects of their lifestyles while they sustained other aspects. The outcomes may not have been entirely deliberate in terms of actively choosing which parts to change versus to maintain, and the surviving physical evidence does not reveal what people were thinking or feeling at the time. Today, we can acknowledge that people in the past coped with a significant change in sea level and in the larger environments that they inhabited. The adaptations certainly were not abrupt solutions or choices, but instead they developed gradually as extended processes of multi-generational learning and interaction with the changing environment. In every case, the outcomes involved not only a change in the natural history of the physical environment, but also a change in the cultural history of the social context. Toward applying this knowledge in our modern situation of rising sea level and changing environment, we can recognize that successful adaptation into the future will require multi-generational learning by at least a few generations of people. Lifestyles will need to change in a fundamental structural sense of where people will live, how they will produce and secure their food and water supplies, and how they will interact with each other and with their environments. Knowing about this scope of change, we can prepare for the practicalities of long-term sustainability through various policies and programs about urban developments, renewable energy production, farming and forestry practice, and other issues. Meanwhile, we can learn more about the long-term records of archaeology and about traditional culture, history, and language toward preserving and sustaining these aspects through our future changing world circumstances.
Thank you for joining us in learning about ancient sites and traditions of Micronesia. If you would like to learn more details, then I encourage you to visit, in person or online, the Micronesian Area Research Center of the University of Guam. Thank you again for watching this program. I hope that you will continue to explore and discover more.